Hello everyone and welcome back to EUpeople. Today we connect with Roberto Viola, a techie at the head of the digital department of the European Commission. Together we will browse EU digital policies and see how decisions taken today will affect your life tomorrow. We will also navigate its past, pick up some old phones and plug in two satellites. Your Wi-Fi is working, your phone is fully charged, then let's begin. Delighted to welcome Roberto Viola, the digital guru of the European Commission. Some say he only sleeps 4 hours and a half a day, others that he has a brain hardwired for technology. The man who once gave powerful people a headache is full of mysteries. But one thing is for sure, Roberto's work will shape the digital world for the next 20 years, at least. How you ask? Let's find out. Good morning, Roberto.
Good morning, Roman.
Would you call yourself a digital guru?
Oh my God, I would say a digital savvy.
I've seen a picture of you building a computer in the 80s. How come it was the first computers?
Well, the first computers, the personal computers coming on the market, and it was quite common for the digital gurus at that time to build their own computers. I became rather successful. All my family was asking for computer friends. I could have mounted a business out
of it. So you had a factory of computers? You
were a little bit. My wife was not that happy, I can tell you. I mean, the house was full of pieces of computers, memories, and things like this.
I didn't know we could build a computer even. I didn't know that. You buy them.
You can do this. You could do this. Still, you can do it. It's not that common.
Could you tell us, in few simple words, what is the digital single market?
Well, it's a beautiful thing. It's in Europe. You can move around, and you don't feel you are changing country. You don't pay roaming fees. You have the same rules for privacy. You can shop online. You have. You can watch your favorite movies, favorite sports.
How do you do with new technologies? Because it's evolving all the time. So there is a balance, I guess, to make between regulation and also letting the technology blossom. So how do you keep this balance?
It's very difficult, and you have to keep this balance. You have to allow people to innovate, to really disrupt old things and create new one. At the same time, people need to be protected. There should be transparency for the customers, for the people. The rights of the people have to be respected. Privacy, individuality. So, I mean, you have to keep always this fine balance.
To make it understandable to people, could you explain me in one sentence what it means? The key word I'm going to say, and what the EU is doing.
Okay,
so
I'll try.
You'll try. Let's start with Internet of Things.
Well, it's everything connected to the Internet. Your fridge that tells you buy the milk is finished.
Do you have a fridge that is a smart fridge?
Not yet. I'm building one.
And what the EU is doing? And what the EU is doing?
The EU is fostering this technology, the standardization, the safety of these things to make sure, for instance, that your home camera doesn't spy you. And at the same time, it's useful to protect your home.
Artificial intelligence?
Well, it's a computer that can understand things from many different data and things that are happening around and gives you a prediction of what is going to happen.
And the EU in this field?
Well, the EU is doing many things. It's basically introducing artificial intelligence everywhere for the benefit of the citizens. Financing research and also working on ethics.
Big data.
Well, it's a big zero and big one. I'm joking, of course. Big data is zillions of data that we generate with our smartwatch, smartphone, sensors around. And this sea of data can be searched by artificial intelligent machines and allow you to understand much better how things work.
Geo-blocking.
Oh my God, yes, but you felt it, I'm sure. Have you tried to shop online and at the end the website says, sorry, I don't ship in your country?
Of course, Christmas.
I mean, trying to rent a car and you were redirected to a website you didn't want to go. These are forms of geo-blocking.
And the EU is trying to prevent it.
It's abolished. That abolishes geo-blocking. I mean, from Christmas onwards, this Christmas, people will be free to shop online wherever they like.
And what happens if not? If you're still geo-blocked?
If you're still geo-blocked, call me.
Okay, so we're going to put the phone number of Roberto Viola here. Cybersecurity.
It's protecting online everything which has to do with moving data around and making sure that people don't spy in your computer, in your smartphone, don't attack banks, don't attack hospitals. It's a very serious thing.
And fake news?
We call it disinformation. It's all the attempt to alter equitable way of representing information by people that have not really good intentions.
Can we make the digital world ethical? Can we apply the same rules that we have offline, but can we apply them online?
Absolutely. I mean, what applies offline should apply online. So how you behave online should be how you behave offline. People, sometimes they feel they go online, they can insult other people, misbehave. I mean, I don't understand why. I mean, you should be as ethical as you are when you are a human being, when you use your digital self.
Roberto, you remember your first mobile phone? We found it in an old drawer.
My God.
You remember how long it took to type a message?
Oh, yes.
And we were limited in characters. So I'd like to start with a small challenge. Would you be able to draft the full regulation on geo-blocking in this small iPhone? No, alternatively, let's draft Love the Digital Single Market.
Okay.
And I'm going to do it on mine. And
but that's unfair.
We'll see. Maybe you'll be quicker.
Not sure.
So shall we?
Let's try.
Are you ready?
Ready.
Start.
Okay.
I got the auto-correct as well.
Oh, no, but that's really unfair.
I'm done.
Done.
Whoa. 2 minutes.
My God.
I can tell it's really that. How is it to play with the phone?
Quite a challenge, I must say. Yeah?
More seriously, you were at the head of the European telecom regulators when mobile phones were booming. So how was this experience?
Well, you know, when I started to be a regulator, there were no smartphones around, no tablets. Still, to connect to the internet, you had to use what they were called dial-up modem. You had to dial up a number. And they were making kind of strange noises when they were connecting. I mean, it was time. Eh?
You couldn't connect to the internet and at the same time phone as well. I remember asking me to
switch off. Exactly. Yeah.
But so what were you regulating then at that time?
It was the beginning of it, the most important thing, because it was the introduction of 3G and then 4G and then, the regulation to allow cheap prices to connect to the internet, thanks to the EU rules, by the way.
I have some questions from the online audience about phones. So would you be ready to answer some of our audience? So we got Garrett asking, what does actually roaming mean?
Well, that's not a difficult one. Roaming, it's using your mobile phone when you are outside your home coverage, your home country coverage.
And the EU did a lot to lower prices.
No, zero prices. I mean, when you are around in Europe, you don't pay roaming fees anymore.
Another question from Yaonis. Europe developed the GSM standard, as we said, and today is lagging behind Asia and the US in developing 5G networks. Is it too bureaucratic to adapt to new technologies?
Look, I mean, 5G has not yet started, so let's give Europe a chance. We are working hard, very hard, I mean, to make sure, and not in a non-bureaucratic way, I mean, helping researchers, helping companies now to deploy very, very quickly 5G.
Okay, it's not only about regulation, it's also about innovation.
Oh, it's a lot about innovation as well.
A question from Gerhard. Why can't Europe create tech giants? It's a question that we hear a lot. Tech giants like the US or China.
Europe has many industrial giants. it's fair to say it woke up a bit late to the digital revolution, but now we are very serious. So stay tuned, I would say.
Stay tuned. Where would you think the tech giants would be? In which sector?
I would say in finance, digital finance, in robotics, in healthcare. Mm-hmm. I'm sure there will be world leaders. They are already, and they will be digital world leaders.
An interesting question that I discovered: why are mobile phone bills much higher in the US than in Europe?
I would say a combination of factors. Mostly in Europe, you have more competition.
More competition brings lower prices.
As always.
Roberto, I'd like to talk about your first love, space. Mm-hmm. So you joined the European Space Agency at the age of 25.
Yes.
Did you have the Star Wars syndrome?
Well, probably the Apollo one, because when I saw the moon landing and I was 11 at that time, I said, that's something I really would like to do.
You studied in that direction and it was really your...
I would say my generation really had a special love with space.
Also, you see, I see you brought us a nice miniature of the of a satellite, and I'd say it's Galileo. What is Galileo exactly?
Well, in a word, it's the European GPS. It's a constellation of satellites that allows you to know where you are.
And it's used for technologies as well. Is it used for mobile phone?
Well, it's in mobile phones. It's a bit. It will be a bit everywhere. It's a new generation of navigation satellites that will be even more precise.
Mm-hmm. Why should Europe have its own satellites?
Well, first of all, Europe needs to have its own satellites because they are used to watch football matches. What about this?
That's a good reason. I take this one.
It's convincing enough. So we have a very good coverage when it comes to satellite television, satellite telecommunication. Now, navigation satellites, satellites that watch the environment. That's super important to understand what's happening, whether, I mean, when there's a natural disaster, to have images to understand. So, and to rescue, I mean, to rescue people. So in many, many, many different ways, satellites are important. But there's another important reason. Space technology, it's a sort of the front runner of technology. When you move your phone, you know that, I mean, the orientation changes. Mm-hmm. That's called gyroscope. They were invented for space, or the touch screen. Mm-hmm. So all the new things that you now use, they were already used 20 years ago in space. That's why I'm a little bit digital savvy now, I mean, because I've seen it all.
Because of the space. What is Europe's future in space? So what's the next step? Do we go to Mars?
We already went. I mean, well, there are many things to do, many things to do. I mean, the universe is big. Our Earth needs to be understood much better. And also, I mean, we need to continuously evolve towards new technologies. So,
thank you very much, Roberto. Thank you for connecting with us. I have the impression we got so many topics to cover that... It's a never-ending discussion.
If we want, I can have a tent here and we continue.
We could, yeah, exactly. Or we could do many episodes if you wish.
Yes.
Thank you, everyone, for watching. You can comment, share online. You can rewatch the video. But there is a last little game we're going to play with Roberto on European movies. So I suggest you click on this link. In this video, it's a bonus video. For the rest, thank you very much, Roberto.
Thank you very much to you. Thank you.